Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It's the 16th of December. Yes, it's Friday, and yes, I'm probably gonna shift the day I release this update to Fridays instead of Sundays. I always used to record it, and I do record it on Fridays, but the time of it may have varied, and to play it safe, I just released it on Sundays. But I think to try and avoid people maybe working on Sunday, I'm just gonna start releasing it on Fridays as best I can. Maybe sometimes it'll be a day late. As always, I have the chapters, so you can jump to any particular update you care about the most. New videos, so I've started the update of my Azure Masterclass. I first recorded this about 2 years ago. I thought it was time for a refresh, so I'm gonna update all of the modules of the Masterclass. I started off with the introduction and the foundation module and hope to update a module a week. I also did a video using PowerShell Azure Functions to bulk stop and start Azure resources like VMs, VM scale sets, AKS clusters based on an order that was triggered by a priority tag you could set on the VM. So this showed a few different things using the resource graph, using a custom module, writing functions and having those available via the profile. So I showed them all in that video. On to what's new. On the compute side, Azure Dedicated Host now has a restart capability in GA. Remember, Dedicated Host allows me as the customer to buy out the capacity of the entire physical node. It's of a certain SKU, and then I can fill it with whatever sized VMs I want that correspond to the SKU of the host. So if the host was a DV4 type SKU, I could put various sizes of DV4 VMs onto that host. Now, maybe for health reasons, troubleshooting, I can restart the host. This would restart the physical box and any VMs running on it. It's going to restart on the same physical box. It's not going to move anything, but it does allow you now to trigger that restart. And Arc-enabled servers is available in Azure China. So Arc-enabled brings the Azure control plane outside of Azure, could be on premises, could be other clouds. This includes things like policy, inventory, tagging, role-based access control, monitoring, update management, automation, and various extensions. And then on top of that, services like Defender. So now those Arc-enabled servers, which could be virtual, could be physical, could be Windows, could be Linux, is available in the Azure China cloud, as well as Gov and commercial. Onto networking, there are some new both global and regional web application firewall features. Remember, global is when WAF is attached to Azure Front Door. Regional is when WAF is attached to Azure App Gateway. And for both of those, it now has additional detection queries for SQL injection and cross-site script detection. And these are for Sentinel. So now in Sentinel, there are some new queries that are available as built-in templates via the analytics area that can help me detect those types of attacks. There's now Azure Policy. And what that enables me to do is a few different things. I could use Azure Policy, for example, to enforce the use of WAF when I have an Azure Front Door or I have an App Gateway. I could configure or just check compliance on what is the mode of the WAF. Is it in detection? Is it in prevention? I could make sure resource log metrics are enabled. And then for regional only, i.e. when it's attached to App Gateway, there's a new exclusion limit, which are attributes I want omitted from evaluation of a rule. That's up to 200 from what was 40, so a 5x increase. That's the core rule set 3.2 and above. There's now bot manager rule set exclusion rule support. And I can now do an uppercase transformation on my custom rules. So a transformation is something I do to the attributes before it tries to do a match. So I could now convert it all to uppercase, which may help with certain matching scenarios. On the storage side, Azure NetApp Files now has cross-zone replication in preview. Azure NetApp Files, remember, is a first-party service in Azure that's built on top of NetApp Filers. And they've had cross-region replication. Well, now it does cross-zone. So within the same region, I could deploy a volume to AZ1, for example, and then another volume to AZ2, and I could configure a replication from the AZ1 volume to the AZ2 volume. It's an asynchronous replication. It's using the snap mirror technology behind the scenes, and I can define what that asynchronous replication is: every 10 minutes, hourly, or daily. I don't pay for the replication. I would just pay for the additional storage because it is obviously copying the data from one volume to another. So it's taking advantage of the new ability to create volumes in a specific zone and then using that snap mirror based asynchronous replication technology. Database, actually a whole bunch of database updates. So Cosmos DB for Apache Cassandra materialized view. So Cosmos DB for Apache Cassandra enables me to, I have data stored and my application is written to use Apache Cassandra. Well, I can carry on using that Cassandra API, carry on using SQL V4, but it's actually running on Cosmos DB. And then a materialized view is all about, well, I have some table and that table has a certain partition key, how I'm sharding the data, certain primary key. But I want maybe a different primary key. I want a different partition key, but I don't want to take care of copying the data to another table. So materialized view creates a table on top of an existing table. So then I could have a different query, a different key, a different partition key. So this now enables me to, as the application, I'm just doing my write to the regular table. But now I create this materialized view, which could have those different primary, different partition keys, maybe even a filter, so it only has a subset of the data in it, but it avoids the application having to do that additional work, having to do those additional writes. It's just one write to the base table from the application. And then I could have multiple materialized views, but all of that population of the view is happening on the server side, on the back end. Now, I'm still going to have request units consumed as part of that population to these materialized views, but it won't have any impact on that initial application performance. It's all done on a pull model. It's pulling into the materialized view, so there's no impact on that initial interaction. Cosmos DB for PostgreSQL has new regions. Remember, the whole point of using this Cosmos DB for Postgres is this replaces the old hyperscale PostgreSQL. It's built on the Citus extension, which lets me, again, shard that data, have very high performance, very high capacity. Well, now it's available in Sweden Central and Switzerland West regions. And Cosmos DB has updated a number of the API names in really the journey it's going on, where you notice it's Cosmos DB for Apache Cassandra, Cosmos DB for PostgreSQL. It's changing the API names for some of the existing technologies. So before it had Core SQL API, well now it's Azure Cosmos DB for NoSQL, Azure Cosmos DB for MongoDB, Azure Cosmos DB for Table, Azure Cosmos DB for Apache Gremlin. So we're just renaming some of the old terminology and naming that it leveraged. There's new Azure Functions Cosmos DB integration. So this is a higher performance both for triggers and just regular binding. It's using the new V3 Cosmos database SDK. So this enables things like Azure AD based authentication instead of using the primary key. That's optional, but that opens up those capabilities. Flexible MySQL now has Azure AD authentication. Remember, Flexible is the replacement for the old single server of both MySQL and Postgres. The big deal with Flexible is it's built on virtual machines, so I can stop start. I can use things like burstable SKUs. I optionally can have high availability. It understands availability zones. I have far more control of configuration options around MySQL. And with this, what this is going to let me do is now authenticate to MySQL using Azure Active Directory. And that includes things like managed identities. So another resource could now leverage this. Inside MySQL, I then create the various users which map to Azure AD users and groups, and I give them roles within the database. I do need an Azure AD based MySQL administrator to perform those Azure AD user group management activities. And then Flexible MySQL now supports customer managed key. So I can bring my own key for the data protection at rest. The key we're talking about is the key encryption key that's used to encrypt the data encryption key that's actually encrypting the data on disk. So now I can bring my own key stored in my key vault that I can manage the lifecycle of. And then flexible PostgreSQL now has a 32 terabyte limit up from the old 16 terabyte limit, so I can have even bigger databases if needed. And then miscellaneous, Event Hub now has a compaction capability in preview. So ordinarily with Event Hub, I have this big data, huge millions of events per second event ingestion service, and something's going to publish an event to an Event Hub or a Kafka topic, if I'm running in that mode, that's consumed by some event receiver. And those events are normally cleaned away, purged after a certain period of time. What I can do with compaction is instead of purging based on time, it's going to keep the last known value of each unique key. So I have these key value pairs. It will just keep the last value of all of the unique keys. This is going to be useful if I have constant updating of a set of keys. Well, now I'm just going to keep the most recent one. Cost management tag inheritance. I talked about this a few weeks ago, but it's been brought up again. This is the ability that now I can say a tag set on a subscription or resource group will get inherited by the resources inside for the purpose of usage billing. So these are the usage records for the resources that I use for billing, maybe show back and charge back. It's not just regular ARM copying the tag to the resource. It's only in the billing reporting. But this is really useful because maybe in the past, I'd have to use Azure Policy to actually copy a tag from a subscription to a resource or from the resource group to a resource. Now, if I was only doing that for billing purposes, I don't need to. Cost management's going to enable that. And I can even say, well, if the resource has its own value for this tag, use the resource groups or use the subscriptions instead. So it gives me a better ability to administer how the charges are going to be shown if I am doing that based on the tag. System Center Operations Manager Managed Instance. So we think of Operations Manager as this great management tool to monitor on-premises, other resources. It's been around for millions of years. But now there's a managed instance version I can deploy into a virtual network. It's completely managed. I can still use the Operations Manager console, but I just tell it how many agents I have and it will set the number of instances, or I can manually set the number of instances. It's going to take care of patching both Ops Manager and the operating systems it's running on. It uses Power BI for the reporting, so I'll deploy a pack to actually integrate with Power BI to get those reports. It uses Azure SQL MI for its database. I can do all this deployment from the Azure portal, but it's a much simpler way to get on board to this. It does still use Active Directory, so it needs line of sight to domain controllers. It's going to still require an account to create objects in the AD and a group managed service account. So there's still a bunch of requirements that I just need to read and make sure I've got. But at that point, it's a very, very simple environment for Operations Manager. And it can still manage things in Azure and outside Azure. It just needs line of sight from a TCP perspective to those resources. Then Azure Migration business cases in preview. So it's a new ability in Azure Migrate. I have workloads running on VMware. It's going to help me show the value of a migration from that VMware on-premise environment to Azure. So the on-prem versus Azure total cost of ownership, year-on-year cash flow, resource utilization insights, easy migrations and modernizations for Windows and SQL, all of that is going to build inside that new business case functionality. And that was it. So as always, until next video, take care.